went, as is my normal fashion, by giving you a prayer. God, give me the serenity to accept things I cannot change, courage to change things I can, and wisdom to know the difference. Thank you very much.
Listen to and learn from the wisdom of these great literary icons and leaders.
Hello, Tonya.
Not just of our country.
Hello.
Leaders in their own right of our world. So let me appreciate all of you. Let me particularly on behalf of the government and the good people of this great state.
Okay.
Welcome. Our only Nobel Laureate, Professor Olusoyinka. Round of applause for him. And thank you, sir, for accepting to be with us. And a number of you may not be aware, yesterday was actually his birthday. And great men don't pay too much attention to mundane things like birthdays and dresses. And you have seen them, and that's their life. Living simply, but living profoundly, living lives of great impact. All of them. A round of applause for all of them. In the course of this ceremony, the principal has informed me, working with my wife, there is a cake that I've been prepared, because you know the only celebration, anything that looks like a birthday celebration that Prof will permit, is something that has to do with you, the children of our world. So, in the course of this program, that will come. Let me thank our own Bayelsa, Ijo, literary icons, who in their own right are also icons of our world. Professor J.P. Clark, Professor E.J. Alaba, and our own father. He's in his 90s, 96 I hear. 96 years, Dr. Gabriel Okara. The father of them all, our father. Thank you, sir. And you know, our children, let me tell you what I have come to realize in the course of my service to our people in the last 5 years, now I'm going to 6 years. These elders and leaders you see, and many more of them, each time I have need for them, each time I stand for them, each time I call them, each time I need their advice and counsel and wisdom and guidance, they always make themselves available. A round of applause for them again. Thank you. Now, I said,
I'm recording.
But before I yield the floor to the literary giants and icons, for all of us to learn from them, because I'm not one of them, I intend to go back to school after my service, and also aspire to be a professor, because I thought that was what I really wanted to be. After my service as your governor, if I have any desire at all, is to go back to school and teach and write and contribute to the body of knowledge. But I'm not yet qualified to join them. So before I yield the floor to them, Let me repeat what I told you yesterday at the formal commission. Let me also repeat what I've had occasion to mention every time I've interacted with you all. And that the reason we have made this investment, even at this very trying, very difficult period, the reason we have spent over 55 billion now, and still counting in the last 5 years, building educational infrastructure alone in our states. The reason you now have the International Academy, in addition to the 14 other boarding schools, where by 2012, when I took over, there was no single state boarding school. The reason we have this is because we want to groom a new generation of servants and leaders. People who will stand up, do what is right and fair, and have the courage also to say no when no is the right answer. And today, you have some of those who help to mold our mind. When I was your age, and for most of us, when we were your age, we read our works and got inspired. And I believe the rest has been history. So they are here to talk to you, to expand your horizon and your world. And as I said yesterday, if I have any charge to you at all, and I won't get tired of repeating this, is to ask you to fly as high as you possibly can, soar as high as your dreams can take you, and conquer the world. Because you can do it. You are Bayelsa's children, you are your children, you are Nigerian children, you are children of the world. Clap for yourselves again. I have often said, in vain do we build the roads, in vain do we build the bridges, in vain do we put any other kind of development together. Because in the end, any other investment is brick and mortar. In vain do we do all of these or any of these. And you know we have built roads and bridges and we still doing so. We'll continue to do that. But in vain do we do all of those if we do not first build your mind. And so yesterday we didn't come here to commission buildings, no. The day before we commissioned the governor's office, probably one of the best in the country, but then in the end it's brick and mortar. Yesterday we were here not to commission this edifice or any other block. Yesterday we came here to start the process of commissioning your minds. Your minds. And free you from this terrible, terrible grip of ignorance that has pervaded our state for so long, that has pervaded our region for so long, that I believe is one of the major causes of instability, even in our country and our world. Because that is what fuels that iron chain, iron circle of poverty, illiteracy, unemployment, unemployability, criminality, militancy, and all that. The only way we can get out of it is by a revolutionary program such as what we have rolled out in this state. Leaving schools. Now we have 15 of these kinds of schools. Our secondary schools are like tertiary institutions. In this state, we have the best public schools now that you can see in any state. In this state right now, we have delivered on the best public healthcare facilities, and we will continue to do so. So I urge you to take advantage of these facilities. Stay away from criminality, stay away from drug abuse and youth. Stay away from cultism. Stay away from any negative influence that will steer you away from the past that we have all come to lay out for you. I know that I've asked a number of dignitaries before now to come. And don't get tired because many more dignitaries will continue to come. Literary giants are here today. Yesterday, a former political leader, head of state of our country at the tender age of 32, managing a country in crisis. He was here, and I chose him specifically to come and commission this to show what young people can do. You may have guidance and support. We will have many more dignitaries. Business leaders will come. Ambassadors will be here. Any visitor of note that visits me, what I request is an opportunity to interface with you. And many more of our leaders will come. Former presidents will be here. And you know, in this state, this great state, we also have a former president too. He too loves education. I know that. And we have discussed it. At an appropriate time, all of them, one by one, will be here to interface with you. So today, I welcome you all. Sit down. I gave you a chance yesterday to read up their works. Because at your age, I also read all their works. From The Man Died to America, The America, you can see that the River Nun is calling. Read their works in their place. There are people that are in Babylon. And the call of the River Nun at midnight, at New Year's Eve, and all their great works, and several more. I ask you to read up, because you have the giants, the doyens here, to inspire you and open your minds. I congratulate you all and I thank our fathers for coming. And may God bless this great institution and this great state.
Actually, that is not my anthem. Everybody knows that. That comes from Professor Wanisho in that Unlimited Liability Company. It is actually a song I would like all the 1,000 voices in this place to learn how to sing before we leave here this evening, so that all of us will know the song. But more than that, I am happy to be here because I envy all of you children. When the governor was talking about the great things education is going to do for you, I can assure you, after some of us finished primary school, secondary school education became impossible. So that when you are living in times when there are governors who can do this, there is a way in which you ought to celebrate it, and celebrate it very specially. And what is great about today is that we are having great minds who help shape the 20th into the 21st century. All of them here, Professor Wanisho Yuka, Professor J.P. Clark, our oldest poet in Africa, Gabriel Okara, and historian of historian, Labora. I thank you all of you because you have a chance to interact with a past that is also the future. It is a beautiful thing to be alive to see it. So what I am doing here is to help you celebrate, and I'm sure that you will hear with me we add all the facts to what needs to be done here today.
Actually, when I look at the children here, there's this feeling I get. I'm so happy for them because they'll never get to experience what I experienced growing up. They'll never be sent home for not paying school fees. Please put your hands together.
We would like to bring as many of the performers amongst you to this side of the hall.
Oh, finish that job.
Empty.
You are empty at the point.
No, I don't think there is.
Is not an issue there, but I post all that.
Thank you. have to deal with. Life's crisis of the will is here. Raps of the field, welcome you, peace like boundless universe. Now, generous we, awaiting rust and tassels joy, long shadows of the dark trees. Detach a wood smoke, laden tax. While the jams decay, we await the promise of the rust. Thank you.
By Pagliaro Crow. I hear your call. I hear far away. I hear the brief December of this fortune hills. I want to see your face and feel your cold embrace. Or at your wing, set myself and inhale your breath. Or like a tree, to watch my mirror self unfold. I hear your loving call, I hear it coming true, invoking the voice of a child, listen. The river beds hear your silver surface flow, my wind is calling too. Its ceaseless flow impels my hungry king down with inevitable cause, and each dying here, this brings near the seabed call, the final call that steals the crested waves and brings cutting of silence of my upturned king. Oh, incomprehensible God, or shall my pen be? Or shall my pen be my inward stars? Oh, my reverse complex God.
So, when a snail is breaking his shell, where? specific times or moments when you're out? Do you have any specific time or moment when you feel you should write?
I love Nigeria, I love Nigeria,
question asking by somebody whose poem, Abiku, gave us a good picture of the mental data before all the stories we are now telling. Narratives that prepared us for the necessity to fight for our people to be beneficiaries of what God gave us. I'll give this to the professor.
Nobel Laureate. Let me, for the benefit of your ability to reason and use your mind. With that properly applied, you can solve anything, you can conquer war. Therefore, I believe that there is every reason for us to say that we should circumscribe our minds on any issue. In the course of your education and throughout your life, your education, however high it may be, however illustrious, will be meaningless unless you have the capacity to question any and every notion, any and everything, examine everything. And that's why we are making this investment. So don't be conventional. I don't like people putting everybody in a conventional mode. Feel free to question anything, any notion, any theory. But in the end, that's how mankind, our race, has been able to, over the years, make the progress that we have made. Now, tying that up with the question, I believe that, just as the prof said, if you ask the question whether Nigeria should continue to exist as a united country, the answer you will get from the majority is yes. I believe that the continued existence of our nation as an indivisible entity is desirable. There's a very strong case to be made for that. After all, you and I, our people, have been funding the Nigerian experiment for the last 61 years. From your background, from your backyard, they carve out portions of land and call it in Abuja and Lagos and other capitals of the world. They call it oil blocks. And I've said it several. What they sit down in their cozy offices and call oil blocks and give to whoever they choose to give are actually your ancestral products. And so feel free, and don't allow anybody to intimidate you. That's why we're investing in education as a weapon for fighting intimidation and oppression. Question, continue to raise issues about environmental justice. What's going on in all the communities? I've described it several times as environmental terrorism. So nobody should tell us that we have nothing to negotiate about. But several things, too many things to negotiate about. In this state, we have only 8 local government areas as decreed by the powers that be. And yet there are states that have 40-something. So we get less than 1/4 every month. What can I say? I've been governor for almost 6 years. I've never interfered with the allocations of your 8 local government areas. I've never. But right now, there's a crisis, they can't even pay their salaries. The reason is we have no control over what we produce. If we have control over our resources, if I can, with these kinds of resources, put these and several other facilities together, you can imagine what I would have done with the resources. This state would have been like Dubai. And so, for us and for our people, let me make it clear. All the education will not be worth anything if you do not have the courage to say no when no is the right answer. And in the end, that's what I expect this investment to give you the capacity to do so. So the continued existence of Nigeria is desirable. But Nigerians, all of us, have issues to bring to the table for amicable resolution so that we can make our union more perfect, enduring, and sustainable. And there's no crime, there's no shame in saying that. And feel free to question every notion about your country. Thank you very much.
happening in the streets. At home, something you read in the newspaper and it's not absolutely nervous to that idea to be nursed in your mind. Voila. For better or worse, you could do something.
Thank you very much, sir.
You take it, my best.
Hey everyone, my name is Ekin Majesty. I am the Deputy Senior Prefect of this great institution, the HR National Academy. And I have a question for Professor Willie Schoenker. And the question is, has being a Nobel Laureate changed your writing?
And then I'm sure afterwards that